Hi, I'm Dr. Jack West, medical oncologist at City of Hope Comprehensive Cancer Center in Los Angeles. This is West Wind, a podcast focusing on the intersection of cancer care, emerging technology issues in medicine, and healthcare policy. You can find information about subscribing at beaconmedic.com or wherever you find your podcast content. Please leave a review, especially if you like this, and we'd also love to get your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. We're continuing our discussion with Dr. Sandip Patel from UC San Diego now. We have gotten some recent real-world evidence data sets that I think are humbling in that both the Singal paper out of Flatiron and Foundation Medicine from earlier this year in JAMA, and then there was a publication out of Florida by Gehrman and colleagues that was a poster, basically both showing similar findings that on a broader community-based general oncology level, we are not executing well in terms of testing properly or delivering the proper targeted therapy that we should be thrilled to find the opportunity to give once those are there. My concern is that the UCSDs, the MD Andersons, Memorials, and the centers that are the pace setters in doing this work are getting so far ahead of the rank and file ability to practice that it's not translating as it should. And so I just wonder how effective it's going to be to have the dialect of what's being done at the bigger centers become fundamentally unspeakable, unusable, once you get 100 miles away from these leading centers, where you don't have a molecular pathologist, you don't have molecular tumor boards. It takes maybe three or four weeks to get NGS testing back. So, how much of an issue is this of, we see the promise, but it's just a tantalizing, unreachable goal in broad use?
It's a great question. I think there are multiple really good points in that question. One is, genomics is one way of looking at the tumor. We can look at transcriptomics, proteomics as well. And then the question is, we have standard of care therapies, right? So we use these tools to find, this patient has an EGFR mutation that we can target with an EGFR inhibitor in lung cancer, or they have high PD-L1 expression, maybe they're a better candidate for anti-PD-1 monotherapy. So that's one kind of basket. And that's something that we hope to raise the bar, meaning patients with metastatic non-squamous, non-small cell lung cancer hopefully are getting EGFR, ALK, ROS1, and several of the other NCCN recommended biomarkers for which we have appropriate targeted therapy. And I think that is something that's an implementation science question, right? Meaning, is testing done? If it's not, why? Or if it's done, and as you actually talked about recently, if it's done and not followed, which is the worst case scenario, right? Because you ordered an expensive test and then you're not going to do anything with it, why? And how do we avoid those issues? So that's one kind of basket, and that's an implementation science question. And that's often a workflow-based process in which you got to get the pathologists involved because someone's reading the histopathology for these community practices as well. And how do we best integrate tools that allow them to understand these very complex molecular reports that are coming back, which are often not formatted in a very readily understood way, or sometimes actually will have recommendations for treatment that we know are likely not able to positively impact a patient's disease, and it can get very confusing. And so I think
you're talking about basically filling the 70-page report with references about preclinical data or something very, very speculative.
Absolutely. And I think we do a disservice in always trying to find something that's actionable because not everything is actionable in 2019 with the therapies that we have. And it's okay, I think. And I think we don't see this enough, to order a molecular report, not find anything that we have actionable in 2019, either in terms of standard of care or clinical trial, and say, listen, we looked for a needle in the haystack, the molecular aberration for which we have a matched targeted therapy that's appropriate for any disease. We didn't find it. Your best option is chemotherapy or whatever it is. That's okay as long as we're looking appropriately. I think where we get into trouble is this kind of necessity to always find something actionable and then starting to reach for therapies right. when they may not be appropriate outside the context of a clinical trial. I think that's where we start to do patients a potential disservice. And I think that's where these reports can get very murky because remember, for us, we see patients, either lung cancer or on my phase one side, I'll see patients with all different kinds of cancer. Community doctors are seeing every cancer all day long, all the time, five full days in clinic, all different stages. And they have to handle very complex already radiographic information, how the patient's doing, what therapy they're on. And now they have to handle the output of a 400 gene next generation sequencing test for which if you're not doing non-small cell lung cancer every day and you don't exactly remember, what do I do for this exon 20, mutation? You need someone to talk to, right? And so I try to be that person for people in my region area, meaning they can just email me or text me and I'll chat with them about that molecular report. We have molecular tumor boards. We try to make it available so people can dial in a HIPAA compliant fashion and talk about these cases. But I think the best artificial intelligence is the artificial intelligence you don't see. Right? And I think we're getting a lot of hype on some of these because they're trying to make it so visible. But the ability, this is actually an artificial intelligence problem in a sense that AI can actually help us navigate these very complex reports and not, while they won't make the decision for us, and I think that's where we're getting a little into the hype, they can at least make the report curated in a much more rational way, the way, Google and Apple are able to do, and sort the data such that the physician can make the right choice. And I think that's where we're talking earlier about a communication divide. Here's a bit of a digital divide and a genomics divide in the sense of you can order all this stuff, but what do you actually do with it?
Yeah, well, I think that this is a major issue where our wisdom has not caught up with the technology. Yeah. And we don't, at least on a broad basis, have the skills to use these tools optimally, which is not a surprise. I mean, those of us who went to med school more than 5 or 8 or 10 years ago did not have nearly this level of molecular training. So, of course, most of this is just learning while you're doing it. And when you're seeing 12 or 15 kinds of cancer a day, you're not going to see enough of this to retain it at a level that you'd need. And I think that's a real problem. I think we do need to work on better ways to have some partnership of the docs with that subspecialty focus, working alongside of, but not trying to replace the effector arm of oncology care, the people who are actually delivering care to 85% of the patients in the U.S. and also, I believe, a huge proportion of the folks outside of the U.S. as well. So we need to work on ways to do that. I think, we may need to have a more Uber model of humans doing it now until the automated process of AI can do it. But I think I agree with you. That's a potentially killer app use of AI in medicine is to help distill this sea of data into what's the point. And I think it's more than any brain can comprehend right now.
But your point about the Uber analogy or the Lyft analogy is very well taken in the sense that there is actually AI going on, right, to map where the cars are to, optimally placed, right? So when you hail one as a human, the human that picks you up is there in kind of an efficient manner, right? And so I think that hidden layer where AI can help us, as opposed to this kind of need to have a highly visible AI layer and kind of replace what humans actually do well, which is take complex sets of data that have been at least reported to you in a reasonable way and communicate that to other humans. I think that's the synapse, that's the interface that we can do better on. I think molecular tumor boards are a great way of doing that. I think increasingly the ability to do these virtually, and I know this is something you're very interested in as well. And then also, there's some great databases online that I have bookmarked, and I pull them up, myself all the time. And so none of us can memorize everything. A lot of us, I still go to UpToDate, if there's something, I need to look up. And so there are molecular versions of this cBio portal, OncoKB. I mean, the list goes on and
great
on.
Great point. And in fact, I was reviewing a remote case yesterday where I referred to this for a rare mutation that there's data on, but I don't carry that in my head. And I think it's interesting because this requires a change in how we expect to deliver care because you can't keep it in your head all the time. This is not
carbopaclitaxel for everyone all the time, and you know, you're good for 10 years.
Yeah.
This is individualized for the patient, and you shouldn't be expected to know that in your head. You just know where to find it when you need it.
Absolutely.
And that may well be with the assistance of someone else if you're, you know, you don't have the capacity to do that because you have 30 patients scheduled that day.
Absolutely. You know, I remember when I started internship, you get handed, you know, a changed color every year, but you know, the residency handbook, right? And it has basically all the major diagnoses you're going to see and the workup and the treatment. We have those for molecular oncology, that they're online. And I think the issue is when people are busy, it's hard to utilize those tools well, right? Because if you're in clinic, you need something that gets you an answer, right? And so you get these reports, and depending on their level of curation, you can either make the decision right then, or you may need to come back to it, and that's something hard to do. And so one of the things that people may not appreciate is if you have an in-house panel, there's likely a molecular oncologist that you can call, because they're the ones who actually came up with the report for you. And if you don't kind of like the annotation that's already there. The other thing you can do is if you get a vendor, oftentimes there's a MSL, like a medical science liaison. If you're like, hey, what do I do about this mutation? They'll tell you above and beyond what the curator report is. But I think the ideal scenario, frankly, is just having that relationship with, you know, someone local. Maybe they're at the university, maybe they're a molecular pathologist at the hospital, who can be your go-to and kind of help you figure these things out.
Yeah, the problem is we have to make it low friction, because,
yes,
I mean, this is not something that can be done for 30 patients a day.
Exactly.
I mean, there just isn't time built in for that, certainly not with documenting it on Epic.
Absolutely.
Which is 43 clicks.
Yeah. So, oh, they have a reduction.
So one of the other challenges we face is the turnaround time.
Yes.
Particularly with tissue. And, you know, one of the issues is that an oncologist can request it. It may take 3 or 5 or 7 days for the tissue to get out of that local pathology department and to Foundation or wherever it's done. And then it's another typically couple of weeks. But at the end of all of that, it's very commonly 3 weeks or longer before a patient has the results available, or the doc has the results available. And so in real life, it's a full month between, I think we should get this, and here's what we're going to do based on this. Anything to do about that, or, you know, any sense of how much quicker that can get, and how much is a liquid biopsy potentially going to obviate that?
And so you nailed the some of the key points there. And so in our clinics, we have to test for multiple mutations for metastatic non-squamous non-small cell lung cancer. And so next generation sequencing platforms are one way of doing that in kind of a tissue efficient and time efficient manner. Because one thing to remember is this is likely the patient's first therapy, right? And so the cancer is not taking a time out, and they're likely not on other therapy. Though sometimes if they're an extremist, we have to give them intervening chemotherapy while we're waiting for these reports, which tells you how slowly these reports come back. But the other point to make is that that's just to get the report back. We still have to get the medicine authorized, and oftentimes they have high copays, so you need copay assistance. And so anything we can do to, like you said, kind of make it low friction, because this is the patient's first therapy, I think is key. So what I've actually had to start doing in this scenario is in the appropriate setting. Actually, I ordered the cell-free DNA and the tissue-based test at the same time, not with the intent of doing duplicative expensive testing, but the idea that the cell-free DNA, I'll draw the blood that day, and I'll often have a result back in about a week. And that's often even before pathology has sent the slides out. And so if I get my molecular diagnosis, right, if it's a metastatic non-small cell lung cancer patient, I find an EGFR mutation, I'll actually cancel the tissue-based testing and save that for a rainy day. If, for example, the cell-free DNA, you know, doesn't show any aberrations, then at least I didn't lose that week for the tissue-based sequencing to continue. But then we're stuck down the path that you mentioned, which it's probably 3 or 4 weeks to, you know, get the NGS, and you find a mutation, you have to get the medicine and the copay. It could easily be 6-8 weeks in, which is 1 or 2 cycles of chemotherapy. And so one of the points I like to make, especially if you're seeing a patient who may be a never a rare smoker, is we reflex to the therapies that we know. Right. And so many people believe for non-squamous non-small cell lung cancer that carboplatin, pemetrexed, and pembrolizumab is a standard of care. And I believe that as well for non-driver mutation lung cancer patients. But for unknown driver mutation lung cancer patients where I may actually find they have an EGFR mutation and now I'm stuck behind the eight ball, we're stuck behind the eight ball with the patient, because if I'm going to start an EGFR inhibitor, they may have pneumonitis risk, that can become a real problem. And so,
and that's specifically, just to clarify for listeners, that that's because there are data to say that particularly after osimertinib, maybe after other EGFR inhibitors, there's a higher risk of pneumonitis in patients who transition from immunotherapy within the next couple of months to EGFR TKI therapy. That's a particular concern. So sequence matters, and you don't really want to jump the gun in that particular case.
Exactly. And you know they're not going to get a lot of benefit out of the PD-1 inhibitor based on what we've seen for those particular molecular aberrations. And so, like many things in medicine, the best treatment's prevention. And so often just give them carboplatin pemetrexed while I'm waiting for their NGS, and then add the pembrolizumab in cycle two once we find, you know, a KRAS call or, you know, a non-driver mutation kind of profile, in which we know a KEYNOTE-189, a carboplatin pemetrexed pembrolizumab type regimen would be their ideal regimen. And so that's typically what I've done, because I have, in many cases, had patients referred, they're never smokers, they're already on this therapy. I get an NGS panel for them, and then we find they have an EGFR mutation, and we're stuck on what to do next, and it's never easy.
How confident are you in liquid biopsies, just the reliability, the sensitivity issues, both for early testing and potentially obviating the tissue with a fast turnaround as well as a big advantage? But even we saw some data at ASCO about, you know, early results on treatment, potentially predicting response to therapy or early prediction of progression. I mean, where do you see liquid biopsies fitting in, not just initially, but even as a serial test?
Great question. So I think liquid biopsies, there are multiple flavors. There's, you know, plasma cell-free DNA, there's CTC-based, and in sequencing of CTCs, there's now some exosomal type strategies that are being looked at. I think for, you know, plasma cell-free DNA, I think when you get a call in terms of in cell-free DNA, it comes back with an EGFR, ALK rearrangement, you have confidence because the specificity of these tests is quite high. Now, the sensitivity in cell-free DNA, especially for lower stage disease or low shed tumors, can be problematic. And that's when you're glad that you kind of started the NGS ball, the tissue-based NGS ball rolling. But I think, so for what questions, meaning what gene is mutated, I think cell-free DNA, if you find something, I feel reasonably confident it's there. The specificity is quite high, though the sensitivity for low shed tumors or even lower stage disease, which one can debate even whether it's appropriate to be ordering that test, I think is a bit more of a question. And I think for questions for how much quantitation, I think it's hard because what value are we adding in the sense that we know we're going to get scans, you know, maybe 2 months in clinically, right? We know, we get a sense of how the patient's doing. And then what am I going to do with that result, right? Anytime you order a test, you know, how is this going to change how I take care of the patient? Let's say their fraction is dropping nicely. Well, they're clinically hopefully telling me that when I see them in clinic, and I'm going to go to the first scan anyway. And if it's higher, but they're feeling okay, what am I going to do differently, right? And so that's the hard part about
that. That's something we always struggle with. I mean, whether it's looking at CEA or, you know, many of us have very little enthusiasm for PET scans because people fret about the SUV going from 5.1 to 6 in a patient whose lesions are the same. They feel fine. And it feels just like making that change is premature, like you're just, don't just stand there, do something.
Exactly.
You know, changing lanes in traffic for the sake of doing anything. But you're not really moving things forward. I think one of the challenges of liquid biopsy, as appealing as it is it has to be economically feasible. I mean, doing a test that costs four times more than the CAT scan is not a benefit. If it costs less and is just a phlebotomy and obviated the scans more than, you know, occasionally, then maybe that makes sense. I mean, it's nice to know, but yes, you're right that we have the clinical information of how a patient is doing. I mean, many of us would be reluctant to be rash in making changes, even if you saw a lesion growing, but a patient felt well, particularly if you don't have a lot of other options.
Exactly. And so I think, you know, like many things in medicine, if we're not going to necessarily make a change based on the test, why do the test? And I think your analogy about CEA is very well taken because it's kind of a more complex CEA. We've all had the patient, oh, the CEA went from 3.8 to 4. You know, what do I do now? Do I get a PET scan kind of thing? Sometimes too much information can lead us astray. And I think your analogy about weaving in traffic, especially for two people from Southern California talking, is very appropriate that you can actually create problems, right? You can overreact to scans. You can overreact to blood tests. I think that's one of the things, you know, in oncology, that I think I get a lot out of Twitter in many ways, and I like following certain groups of people that I normally don't get to interact with as much. And one group is the patient advocates. I get to see them in a very kind of controlled, finite setting sometimes, but I don't get to hear their, you know, fears as being patients, right? And we know about scanxiety, we know the term, but we don't know like the breadth of scanxiety or the depth often in our patients, because they'll only tell your nurse, right? Because they don't want to tell you because they're worried it'll either eat at a time or you'll do something different or you'll scan less frequently or things like that. And so one of the things I get a lot out of social media from is, and I think we were on this thread a while back, is that, for example, I didn't know contrast, right, was this big issue for patients. I knew radiation was, and I get asked the radiation question all the time, but contrast. And so, you know, how do we handle this? And how do we discuss this? And how do we handle discussions around things that the patient kind of is pocket vetoing in terms of the clinic because they don't want to get a subpar scan? And then how do we avoid over-testing or sending so many tests that we actually create either scanxiety or whatever the version of scanxiety is for self-reading?
Actually, we're going to have the enviable problem of, you know, people on TRET therapy a very long time. Yeah. And getting a lot of scans. I mean, some of the people who are most concerned about contrast are the fortunate ones. Yes. Who are living years and years with advanced lung cancer. And I hope we have a lot more people like that. But we need to prune back our rituals.
Yes.
Of, you know, well, we're going to do a scan because it's been 2 or 3 months. Yeah. Well, you know, I don't think that needs to apply in trials or life after 2 years.
Yeah.
We can probably ratchet back a little bit and ask questions of, how often do we really need the contrast? And you know, I'm, as we talked about, I mean, we're looking for clinically significant changes. My sense is often if a patient is doing well and you can't see it on a basic scan, it's probably not, you know, horrifyingly bad progression. So
exactly.
I think these are the things that we all get into ruts, and we may be insensitive about where we just do rubber stamp things because that's the way we've always done it. And I think that anything that, you know, holds up the mirror and says, well, why do we need to do
exactly
this? Yeah.
And I think that's one of the secret issues with the EMR, to be perfectly honest, is that it makes it too easy to treat the simulation of the patient, you know, rather than the person in front of you, right? In the sense that, you know, you're sitting there at the computer answering their questions. The orders kind of go in the computer, the data kind of comes out of the computer. And then you kind of get in this rote rhythm that, oh yeah, the typical, this is every 3 months, 4 months, but really precision medicine and personalized medicine is, well, this patient's 90 years old and, you know, has other comorbidities, and maybe we don't need to bring them into clinic so much because it takes them 2 hours and need a ride to get in. Because let's say we found something 6 months later, we could still do something about it and they have other comorbidities. And so I think one of the things I worry about with the EMR, in addition to kind of the burnout issues, is that it kind of creates this almost mathematical, almost algorithmic view of how we take care of patients who are of a specific stage. And I think that would be a tragedy.
But it is a way to potentially exert change quickly. In other words, it's like seeing something just coming out about, well, we did a tweak in the EMR and we changed this default setting.
Yeah.
And now we're doing half as many scans. And so it's the same concept as the nudge of just changing organ donation on you know, state license from an opt-in to opt-out, and all of a sudden everyone's doing it. And so I think that if it doesn't require Epic to do a 6 month or longer, you know, turnaround to make a change, you know, if we could look at these with fresh eyes and ask, well, maybe we don't need to do it this way. There are ways to change what we're doing and make broad, you know, in broad strokes.
Absolutely. And I think that's a great point. I think the behavioral economics, right, so to speak, of how we can interact with the EMR and how with patients, I think, and communicate these ideas to say, listen, you don't need to get a CT scan with contrast every 2 months. You're 3 years into your, you know, anti-PD-1 therapy. Enjoy. You know, you don't have to fly back for the scan. That kind of thing. I think that's part of precision medicine, right? Is tailoring the therapy and tailoring what we do once patients are doing well, or even if they're not doing well, the ability to peel back. And so, but I think we underappreciate, as you mentioned, with some very good examples, the power of defaults and the power of default settings, and who controls those default settings, and how we can use that in a virtuous way.
Where do you think oncology in general, or thoracic oncology more specifically, is going to be in 5 years? I mean, I'm not talking about the teleport to work kind of thing, but just evolving from where we are, Do you think that immunotherapy is going to be just routinely used far more across the board, even in earlier stage? Do you think that everyone will always have NGS panels done? Do you think that targeted therapies will be used in a much higher proportion of patients and will have the broad knowledge base to use that information?
Yeah, I think if you had told me we would have two KRAS inhibitors for a specific isoform, you know, in clinic in concurrent development, that looked promising. It's very early. They haven't been compared in randomized controlled trials. But the fact that we have two interesting KRAS inhibitors in clinic in 2019 for what was initially a gene that was thought to be untargetable or undruggable, I don't know if I would have said that in, 2014, right? That this is something that's down the pike. And so I think the truly undruggable aberrations may actually start to decrease over time in the next 5 years. And thus, if we start to have drugs that target KRAS, right, that maybe in a unique way target STK11 or even target P53 or RB, right?
I was actually thinking about that as you talked, yeah. If that happens, I don't know what the world will be like.
But that's the kind of innovation, and that's the beauty of the job in terms of the research side of things is there are people working on this. And, you know, if there is something that is broken in the genome, we're not perfect at fixing things, but who knows, we'll be doing CRISPR to fix this in cancer cells. Will there be a great vector that goes directly into cancer cells and corrects all these P53RB aberrations? I mean, it's just that there's a universe of possibilities, right? And so, you know, this is a bit, it's definitely science fiction right now, but if you told me a small molecule that targeted KRAS would be in, two of them would be in clinical trials 5 years ago, I don't know if I'd believe
you. And look appealing.
And look appealing. Yeah. And so I think as you get more targets, you're going to need to know if a patient has those targets in their genome, in their cancer genome. And so it tilts the balance towards wanting to do more profiling, right? Because now if you have a KRAS inhibitor, EGFR inhibitor, ALK inhibitor, ROS1 inhibitor, RET inhibitor, NTRK inhibitor, HER2 inhibitor, and whether it's an exon 20 insertion, you know, you have drugs for all these different targets, you are kind of going to have to test to see if patients have them. And then immunotherapy, I think, is... Right now, immunotherapy is basically the metonymy of saying anti-PD-1 directed therapy, right? Maybe the melanoma docs and the renal cell docs talk a little more about CTLA-4 based approaches. But I would be surprised if in 5 years, we're still doing a lot of PD-1 monotherapy. I think some of the drugs that are currently in development that target other parts of the immune system, because these drugs fundamentally are prodrugs. PD-1 inhibitors and CTLA-4 inhibitors are drugs that go into the body that act on your own immune cells that you're hoping are within you. And we have these kind of dirty biomarkers that look at the shadow of the true biology, right? Whether they're PD-L1 immunohistochemistry or tumor mutational burden, which may or may not have a role in how we take care of patients some anytime soon. But the idea that fundamentally, if we can actually stack the deck with ACEs in the patient's favor, do cellular engineering in solid tumors, kind of like what liquid tumor patients have had with CAR T therapy, or have drugs that frankly target the dozens of other immune cell types that are likely important in cancer, whether they be NK cells, macrophages, gamma delta T cells, I think we're going to see a lot of investigations into those therapies. And then the question is, how do we decide which immunotherapy to give a patient? We need a multiplex assay. What will that look like? This is actually one of my frustrations on the phase one side, and actually part of the reason, kind of as we speak, I'm starting a lab, and I didn't have a lab-based background aside from doing some research. But now I want to try to better figure out how to match patients to immunotherapies, because we don't have an NGS for that by any means.
Well, I would envision that many of these things are still a little more than 5 years out, but I would say that in a world where we have finally gone past the impasse of stage three chemoradiation being the seemingly impassable standard of care for 10 to 20 years, small cell lung cancer now having a few agents that are potentially changing the standard of care, I would say that there's plenty of reason to be hopeful. And again, you know, KRAS, seeing things that seem to be insurmountable in the past, I would say that we should never be resigned that there's things that we cannot work around. So that's great.
5 years ago, do you think you'd be using the cure word in clinic for metastatic patients?
Yeah, I think that's really the issue. In fact, one of the questions that I'm really interested in assessing for my colleagues what they think is whether with 5-year survival in previously treated patients getting immunotherapies, if that's getting to 20 to 30%, and many or most of those people don't have evidence of progressing disease now, can we think of this as a cure? And, you know, if not, when is that?
Yeah.
And the fact is, even if we can't say that, the fact that we can ask the question is amazing. And, you know, I would just say that it has changed my conversations with patients to say, what is possible?
Yeah.
I mean, it's amazing to, and the fact that these are often patients who are not the never smoker adenocarcinoma patients who we always could talk about years of survival and a very long tail. Immunotherapy opens up a whole new range of long-term potential for people who we could never have that conversation with. So I think it's great. And what to me is so attractive, both about targeted therapy and immunotherapy, of course, when it works for the beneficiaries, it's beautiful. But everyone has that hope. I mean, just to be able to be given a handful of lottery tickets with a big payoff is, everyone appreciates that opportunity, even if it doesn't work miraculously for them. Well, thank you so much for spending the time.
Thank
it's great talking to you.
Thanks so much for joining me today for this West Wind podcast. We hope you'll be interested enough to subscribe either by checking out the options at beaconmedic.com or looking for West Wind Podcast on iTunes or wherever you find your audio content. Please take the time to submit a review, and we'd also welcome your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. Until next time, this is Dr. Jack West. Thanks for listening.